following interview was conducted with Charles R. Hicks, Emeritus Professor of Purdue University for the Purdue University Orchestra Program. It took place on Tuesday, January 14th, 2008, at his residence in West Lafayette. The interviewer is Katherine Markee, the Orchestra Librarian. Welcome. Tell us a little bit about where you were born and your parents.
Oh. Well, I was born in Syracuse, New York. Lived there most of my life before I came to Purdue. I did have 2 years in at Eastman Kodak in Rochester during the war with a naval ordnance group. And we were making proximity fuses for the war effort. That was about 2 years of that, but I got back into teaching again at Syracuse, because I went to see my old major professor, Isaac Squire Carroll. I never forget that. And he said, well, why don't you join our staff? I went there and heard that there were some openings at high school level and so on, and that been all right, because I wanted to get back into teaching. It didn't matter where. So I stopped to see him, and he said, join the faculty, which I did. And of course, we had all of the GIs coming back.
This is after the war?
Yeah, very busy. And they did push me to get a doctorate, but they said I could take courses toward that. Well, I had a physics master's, by the way, in Syracuse at Purdue. No, it must have been at Syracuse. Yeah. Right after the war, not after the war, but I got a master's in physics. And then I came out here, but my main interest was at that time, because of context during the war, quality control and statistics. And so that's how we got involved in this position. Then the top person in the country, in my book at least, was Irving Burr. I don't know if you've heard of Irving Burr, but Irving Burr has done a lot of writing and done a lot of counseling and consulting, and I wanted to come here to work with him.
He was here.
He was here. He is a graduate of the University of Michigan. But now, when I first talked to, well, my major, head of the mathematics department in Syracuse, for whom I worked, wanted to know where I wanted to go after I got my degree. So I gave him some names, one which were Purdue University, and I was thinking about working with Irving Burr. And it turned out that they were interested, but they wanted somebody for Calumet. But I didn't want to be way up there someplace. I know nothing about the state of Indiana. So I decided I'll just stay here longer, because I was an instructor so long that I had tenure at Syracuse. They didn't want me to pay attention to that, but they did. Because my major professor at that time was a statistician. And he said he's afraid I wouldn't go. But it was a smart thing in the world to go in a different environment and all that. And working with Burr was wonderful, because we had an office together until I got into administration.
Now, you finished your PhD when you came here?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Was there an opening? Is that how you happened to come to?
I don't know. Oh. Well, Burr called me.
Okay.
And I didn't, I'd seen him at some conventions and the
sure.
like. Didn't know him, really. I'll have to go back and tell you this story, because I think that to some of us, it's kind of a miracle that happened, really.
Yeah.
It seems that I had applied here and told you that I didn't want to go to work in Calumet. So I'd forgot about Purdue. And one day I was out consulting some company in the Syracuse area. And the telephone, they called me the phone, and it was Irving Burr. I have three questions for you. Are you still available? Yes, that was kind of late. In the spring, maybe May or something. And second question, are you still interested in Purdue? Well, if I can work with you there, yes. And thirdly, would you have your doctorate? And so I crossed my fingers and said yes. I was defending it that summer. So that's how I got to come to Purdue. And And as I told many people, Helen and I, Ruth and I, my first wife, we prayed for some guidance in this business because we believe a lot in the power of prayer and so on. But we never said anything to her over the phone about the arrangements, what I do here. But we wanted three things, or hoped for three things. We'd been instructors so long, it had to be at least an assistant professorship. And secondly, it had to be about $5,000. Now, that was a lot of money then. I was probably earning $3,900 in Syracuse. It has to be about $5,000. And it has to be three-quarters time teaching and a quarter time research. I wasn't much interested in research, but I know that you have to do some of that, you know. And lo and behold, I got a letter from Dr. Cossack. I don't know if you would have known him. He was head of the statistical laboratory in long gone. But he wrote me and made me an offer. And the offer was for $5,000, assistant professorship, three times teaching and quarter time research, like I had written it.
And you hadn't even spoken about it?
No.
Just
not even a word. No.
Oh.
So that was the place to come.
Yeah.
So that's why we came here. And I finished my doctorate there in statistics.
At Syracuse?
Yes. It was a joint affair, as it is now, has been since, because the education department hired Eric Gardner, who had just finished his doctorate in it at Harvard, and he was a young professor, of course. But I had wanted more statistics work than they could offer there. I'd taken all the courses they had, and occasionally somebody come in as a visiting professor. So I was working something out with the math department toward a degree. But then when he came here from Harvard, I worked with him, and McSoon was teaching his classes as well as my own in statistics in the education department. And so that's how I got involved in both departments and have been ever since.
Okay. What was the campus like when you came?
To tell people one thing about that. I can't tell you what the number was. I noticed a thing you gave me that Barbara Cook said something about how many people, but they didn't know that. I didn't know in 1953. All I can say is that when we had a faculty meeting, we met in Loeb Theater, and that all the faculties met together. That's as small as it was. I don't know how many people.
All the faculties of the school?
All the faculties of the university met once a month or so, maybe not that often, a couple times a semester. The whole faculty. Now, they couldn't even begin to do that today.
Now, this is for the researchers. The department, this was a Department of Education within, what was the school? Was that the
school?
Was it SEH, the Science Education?
It was Science Education, SEH.
Right.
And so then to go forward from that, I taught statistics here and worked with Burr and consulted a lot of this sort of thing. And then in 1960, I guess it was, the Dean Ayers was the dean at that time, Bill Ayers. Dean Ayers and one of the vice presidents of Purdue, Don something. Anyway, they wanted me to stop and talk with them. I was on my way. I always taught at Syracuse summers. They invited me back to teach in the summertime, so I went back there. We have a summer place in the Adirondacks. We still do. And so I would be there, but I was asked to teach at UCLA. And I think 4 years, 4 summers, we went out to UCLA teaching a short course. And so I was on my way across the country when I was going to take the family with me that time and so on, in some place down in New Mexico or somewhere. I got the phone call from them, and they wanted me to be an assistant dean. Well, so they wanted me to stop here first, and they talked to me about that. And I said, well, I didn't care anything much about it, but after I had been, I was assistant dean for a little while, 60 to 64, along there, and I was assistant dean in charge of counseling. We set up a counseling system, a lot of professors involved and all that. But I had been trying to help them find the dean of education. You see, the problem was we didn't have a school. We had a dean of education, Paul Alexander, you may have heard of him, but he was in charge of the Teacher Education Council, which voted on, one of these programs should take to the state and all of that. And so he had no faculty, no budget. He was dean, like the graduate dean, you know. And so, as a result of that, I thought about this job, working with them, but I told them, they wanted to know what I made as a consultant. So I said, this is going to surprise you when I tell you that. You probably won't want me. And I forgot what it was I told them, but whatever it was I told them, that I was consulting about a day a week. That was normally procedure. And a lot of short courses in the summer, and I didn't want to work summer, so I wanted to go to camp, and I wanted to take in some short courses, like at UCLA, four summers or what out there. So, in all of that, they still wanted me to come, which I did, and took the job. And after they made it worthwhile, I guess, at least I enjoyed it all right, that much administration. But I was trying to help them. You see, it's science, education, and humanities. And the assistant dean in charge of education felt that they ought to have a school of education. Well, a lot of people over there did, naturally, that I worked with. But he went over to see President Humpty, and he said, I think we should have a school of education. And Humpty accepted his resignation right then. He went down to Michigan, pretty good guy. But I thought, as there were three of us, assistant, Dean Ayers was the dean, and this fella, Johnson, was the associate dean, and I was an assistant dean. That was it, in
the
SEH. Mm-hmm. And so, as a result of that, I got a lot of good experience there, but I was trying to help them find someone. We had a couple of pretty good prospects here, but once they saw our setup, they didn't want it, part of it, because you didn't have a school of education. But as you know, some schools of education were kind of under the gun in those days. I mean, Hovde and John Hicks would never hear of the school of education. So I knew better than to ask for it, but I was trying to find them someone. And I think Dean Ogle from SEH and Alexander, Dean of Education, were in Chicago. They were visiting the problem of finding somebody in education to be head of department, and somehow they ganged up on me, and I think they scraped the bottom of the barrel at that point. But so obviously I took the job as a professor of education and as head of department in 1964. So that's how I got into administration. I liked it all right, but I had some friend who, pretty good personal friend, who I said 10 years on a job would be enough. And if you don't come around and kick me in the proper part of my anatomy after 10 years, I'll quit anyway. But so I was actually 11 years. The time we got around to getting someone, Bob Kane became the dean. Did you know Bob Kane?
I may have met him.
He became dean. So they called
but then in the meantime,
an interim dean.
But then in the meantime, it became HSS&E, right?
Oh, yeah.
Right.
I had an opportunity to teach in Florida, year 64 and 5, along in there, 3 and 4, maybe. And so I was down there teaching when I was hearing all about they're going to take, science was going off by itself. It was going to have humanities, social science, which was known as HISI. And I didn't know anything about where I'm supposed to be. I wrote to Paul Chena, who was real, vice president or something. And he said to me, he wrote me a letter and said, there's two or three things you can do. Because I was down there as a professor of industrial engineering. I'd had some contact with the people here. And so I had a quarter time already in industrial engineering, even when I was teaching statistics. And so I decided that after 10 years, that's long enough. And so Bob Kane became the dean. We had looked all around, and we went for our own person. Of course, I didn't hire Bob, but he was here when I came, but went ahead of the department. Wonderful guy. You didn't know him, huh?
I don't think so.
Bobby is still around. His wife may be worth interviewing.
Okay. Is Bob still alive?
Right.
Bob Kane, is he still alive?
No. Oh. He had cancer and passed away. About a year ago, a little more.
I remember, yeah. Shortly after they had their anniversary, as I recall.
Yeah, that's right.
Right, okay, right.
And so that's how I got involved there. And then I always tried to teach in class every semester when I was administrator. Because it's hard to keep your hand in it if you don't do it. Then I consulted about a day a week. Although as administrator, they didn't probably like this, but I still consulted. I couldn't take my summers off anymore, but I had to work full time.
Right. What were some of the things you've appointed, the teacher training you were involved in that? You were the director of the teacher education and chairman of the teacher education council during that.
All right. Paul Alexander was chairman of the teacher education council. As I said, all of the programs we had, programs at least five schools
in the area of education.
Because we strongly believe in having subject matter. In other words, math education, physics education, English education. And we hired a number of people as joint professors on purpose to have some of the top people in their field that our
subject
students
specials
would have to get when they were training. And we always had that emphasis, and still do, I believe, on subject matter. Of course, we had to develop some courses in education and the like, and they did.
Sure.
But, so when that school was split, I could have gone in as industrial engineer and come back into statistical lab, or stay and work with somebody in. But as I say, after that happened, about the early 60s.
Mm-hmm.
I was
right
down in Florida. Finally, Dean Ogle wrote me a letter in which he just had to come and be his assistant. Well, I hadn't had anything like that from Sheena, and I didn't know that I had a job down there if I wanted it. So then I came back here. And then after that year, Dan was department head for 10 years, 11 years. And we put the emphasis, as I say, on subject matter orientation, but also research. When I went into the Department of Education, they had one person doing research. He was doing it in ag education, and he had a $5,000 or $10,000 grant from the department in Indianapolis, in education in Indianapolis. And nobody else was doing any research, wasn't publishing anything. And you know, that has to be done. I was not heavy on research, but was a blind spot. So I hired a gal who was on our faculty already, Mary Andrews. I don't know if you've heard of Mary.
I've heard of her name, right, yeah.
She's the one responsible for setting up elementary education at Purdue. You see, everybody thought for a long time, time, the Purdue, but IU handled education, or one of the state teachers' colleges handled education, but we had a strong secondary program, and then Mary Andrews had set up a program for elementary, and so she developed that area, but she went over to teach in some foreign country in Africa. I can't tell you which it was, but anyway, she was there a couple of years. And President Hovde told about two things he told me. If this didn't work out in head of education, he always had a place for me, someplace in administration. But then the other thing that he said to me was, Mary Andrews is over in someplace in Africa, and when she comes back, you tell her she can do anything she wants to in the department. That you have to do. Well, I was perfectly happy to do that. I thought she'd come back and handle elementary ed, which she developed really here. Instead, she saw the need for research, as I did. Well, I went along with her on it. And so we hired two full professors in research professors, Bill Asher and Larry and McDaniel. Do you know those guys?
Yes, I do.
All right. And we hired them as full professors to set up a program, and there's lots of money around in those days for projects, you know, sponsored by the federal government. And so we tried to develop this and also to try to hire a top-flight faculty. Now, when I went over to the department, there was two things as faculty. I don't think they were told that whether they wanted me or not. I think after all the searching they'd done, they decided that I had to do it. Faculty had no voice in it, I guess. However, what we did there was to set up a scheme whereby teachers who would work on a, and a lot of them had ideas, you know, work on some project, get funded for the project, and then they would go part-time on that project. We would have to hire somebody in their place, temporarily at least, and there'd be a difference in savings right there. And that money was then used for faculty members who wished to apply for it to continue to do research here at Purdue, you know, whatever they wanted to do. And so Asher, McDaniel, and I really set that thing up. And we had a lot of pretty good research done. Well, when I got through this head, I think it was about $1 million, which still isn't
no small
today,
change.
But it was then. And considering we'd had none almost, that a lot of people got into the act, did the work. So that's how we got going in research in that department.
How about promotion and tenure? Was that effective? That was a lot different than it is today.
Tenure?
Yeah. But the research aspect probably helped.
Well, of course, it's still true, I think, that the first, the best road, the fastest route to promotion is to be doing research. And I felt the person had to do one of two things besides teaching. They had to go into research, part-time anyway, doing research, or administration. And so I'm in administration. And we hired people in subject matter and education and put that program together, pretty much.
Good.
And so when I stepped down, we had a pretty good research thing going. I guess they've kept that up.
Sure.
I don't know if they still have. Last I talked to Bill Asher, they still had some of these grants they could get because of monies they saved doing projects.
Sure.
And so on.
Right.
So that's largely what we did for education, I guess, in all those years.
How about the student? The student, student increased, enrollment increased?
Oh, yeah. We had a big increase in enrollment. In fact, that had started with Bill Ayers in liberal arts, the humanities part of HISA, or, well, even before that,
SCH, science even, education.
Yeah, at that stage, SCH was aiming to increase beyond the number of engineers we had here. Now, that would never be heard of Purdue. But Dean Ayers would always throw that out. In a couple of years, we're going to be bigger than you are, you know, that sort of thing. Ridiculous, but it was true, of course. And they didn't want anything bigger than engineering. And so they split the school up. They had science by themselves. And not at that time did they have education. We had it later.
Right.
But all of those were split up in those days.
And you were in the old education building.
In the old education building, which I tried to burn down once without any success. It was an awful old building, and it was built for chemistry.
I remember even the library.
And most of our...
Marge Sumstein was the librarian.
Yes.
Oh,
did you know
her? Oh, I knew Marge. Carolyn Whiteneck. I was going to ask you about her. Yes.
Carolyn Whiteneck.
I remember I helped her out with some of those summer programs.
Sure.
Through Keith Dowden. He's the one I got to know Carolyn, and I really enjoyed that.
Carolyn, great. You know, that was one of the things I was the proudest of, that I got her promoted to full professor. She had about ready to retire, but I got it done. And there
did
you
she not back. Have a PhD?
No, she didn't have a PhD. I think you're right. I don't think she had a PhD. And of course, you know, you had to write, do something.
Right. Those summer workshops were wonderful. I loved working with the kids on there.
Yes.
She did a very good
she
job.
She was very
and she was
good.
Active in the state.
And everybody admitted how good she was, except when it came to promotion. And you have to take through all these other committees, not just your school. Our department and the whole school were behind it, but it got blown out of the water. And that happened to the fellow that did the research in ag education. Happened to him, too, that he couldn't get promoted to full professor. That one, Fred Hutty, took on his own wing and did it. So, that's what has to happen.
There was another person that I was going to ask you about, in addition to Carolyn.
There
was Lee Isaacson in Bush.
Lee was my associate professor. Lee was head of the counseling and guidance division, probably now be a department within the school. And Bruce Sturzer and Shelley Stone and...
what about Norbert Nelson was another
Norbert
one.
Nelson
and then
was
Felton's
for administration.
Right.
He was head of, we set this up just like a school, even though we didn't have a school.
Sure.
We had sections. And each of the sections reported back to the school and or the department. We ran the department. Well, you have to. You've got teacher training and teacher, and you have to observe teacher training, teacher, and you have research and all of the, and you have a placement operation, and so that. There's so many things you do there that other departments didn't have to do.
Right.
So it wasn't too hard to convince them that we ought to have a school, but I never asked them for a school because I knew that the head shed, as we call it, didn't want it, and we couldn't get it done. The second thing they wanted was a building. Boy, we needed that, but I didn't push that either. I tried to concentrate on building top-flight faculty. I think in some ways we did. Some of those people are, of course, retired now.
Right.
Some of them are still around.
Right.
Like the fellow in biology education who was heavy into computers. Lehman. Lehman.
Came on.
Yeah. There are a few of those people that I hired. Crockover in science ed.
Sure.
But most of them have retired by now. But that,
you had
we
quite
did
a big
get
group.
Some real... top-flight people over time, for a long time.
Let me ask you something about the Charles Hicks Chair of Education. Ed Nichols, I understand, were on his PhD advisory committee, and he provided funds for the chair. But he also provided funds for chairs named after Harold Amrine and James Green, didn't he?
His wife. And
what was your relationship?
Amrine, yes. That's an interesting story. Hasn't come to fruition yet, but anyway, it's getting there. But it seems that...
But your chair is in education.
My choice. It's in education.
Sure.
Ed Nichols was a student here and got his doctorate. And, of course, one of my jobs in industrial engineering was to work with their graduate students on design of their departments and that part of statistics.
Sure.
And so I was working with them, and Ed was one of the students. Another fellow was Bob. It's going to be hard now. He went on to become head of the department at the University of Florida. And, of course, he's the guy that got me to come down to Florida for a year. But they were both, got their doctorate here. And Nichols was a student. He took some of my classes. Of course, he had to, I guess, statistics and so on, the PhD in that day, anyhow. And so I didn't know him that well. I mean, he was a fine student and all that. He worked hard at it. But this came completely out of the blue that somebody came and told me this, that they were going to establish this chair in my name. Only one in the Department of Education, and that was Feldhues, and had the Robert B. Kane professorship. But there weren't any others at that time. There probably are now. But he wanted to establish this. He established one for his wife, one for the head of the Department of Industrial Engineering. And I had a choice. Nichols gave this money, or promised this money, didn't become there until he died. That was a big problem in a way, but we still had to set it up. And $1.3 million, and that was pretty good then, still, as I thought, before it just came on. But anyway,
still good. How did they notify you about this?
I'm just trying to remember that. Oh, the acting dean of education at that time was Peters.
Oh, Jerry Peters.
Jerry Peters. And he was acting dean. And he must have called me on this, I think so. And so we had a reception, a whole lot of stuff. The president wasn't there, but a lot of top people were there. This is still matter of record archive someplace, but they wanted me to do this, but they gave me the option because they didn't know what to do with it. They were happy to have the money in my name, but I could have that and chair in industrial engineering or a chair in statistics or a chair in education. And you don't normally get a choice, but I had the choice. And I went for education, having been department head, and still having a part-time, or had a part-time assignment there. I know that engineering schools have lots of these professors. Not a lot, but they have some. And surely statistics has some. And so, or mathematics. And so, there was only one in education at that time. I think there are more now, I don't know. But, of course, we couldn't use the money to set this up until Ed died. Ed was my age, and he just died last year. and so we were praying for his death. That's not quite true, of course. But I did hear from him with a Christmas card, usually. Last year I did not hear. And he was in a nursing home. And I never got a chance to see him after all this happened. We had a little correspondence.
He did not come for the reception or anything?
No, okay. He didn't do that.
Uh-huh.
He should have went, but I don't know. He was head of industrial engineering at Rhode Island University. He set that whole thing up, the department there, apparently. I don't know where his money came from. His wife may have had the money. I mean, it takes a little money to have three professorships. But he did. I guess they didn't have any children. Anyway, so all we know is that it's there, but we haven't set up any guidelines for who's going to be named, maybe, until now. You have to wait a year until you get the money. I mean, you get the money. They've got the money right now. Because I was called to a meeting with Dean Hind and a couple other people in education this last spring, I guess it was. And Ed had just died. And they could now have
some plans.
And want to make some plans. I had some ideas about who we might ask and all that. And then they told me that they have to wait a year. In other words, for that capital to give them the first year's interest for a professor. Okay. So we're now waiting. And I'm sorry George Hine left me, but he knew all about it, and so did the acting dean over there. He was at a meeting.
Sure.
Didn't know he was going to be acting dean. Maybe they did. You know, Kevin Kelly.
Right. I saw
the reason I don't know which it is because I have a granddaughter named Kelly, and I have a grandson named Kevin. So this is Kevin Kelly.
It's easy to remember.
I've got to call him in. Congratulate
right.
him for taking this job.
Yeah.
And so we'll be working with him on that sometime.
Sure.
Now, I don't know. Never had experience with professorships to know. But
that's very
nice. I always thought that was primarily for some professor you had there who had been done an exceedingly good job, like Feldhusen had done in education. And they're going to supplement his salary somewhere, whatever they do. But I got the impression from Kelly that they might use this to attract people to come to the education department, school. Excuse me, college. It's college now, isn't it? College, and I wasn't so sure about that, but nobody asked me yet. They haven't come up with any. I got some names on the back of my head, but they'll probably be retired before
That's a very nice thing, though.
But I thought that would be nice for somebody like Feldhusen, who had this professorship before he retired. You know, wait till they retire, you know, then do it. But whatever they use it for, so I got the money. But I was, of course, very pleased with it, but very surprised. Came right out of the blue, you know.
Sure.
I didn't know this guy that well. But I made an impression.
That's right.
Must be. Yeah, you never know in teaching.
Right. But you look back on your career at Purdue. Any comments, general comments you'd like to make? And also an outstanding event. You got one of those?
I felt that Purdue was always a great place to work and live at. It had a very good staff and outstanding presidents. Of course, I didn't know all of them, but I worked under, what's his name? Sure.
Hovde?
Hovde, a little while.
When he was president, when you came?
He was president when I came. He was president 25 years.
Then Dr. Hansen came.
Yes, and Hansen. I knew him probably best. Well, I worked with Hunty, and we did some things together in places when we were, but he never had a school of education yet. And Hansen came along, and he was an awful nice guy to work with. I don't think he went out and got the money like these guys have done today and all of that, but he was student-oriented president, real terrific guy. But then along came Steve Bering and tremendous guy. And Ziske, I didn't know, but I'd met him, and that's about all.
Sure.
But he did quite a job from what I guess he was supposed to do.
Yeah, did well.
Yeah, but I don't know the outstanding events.
Or or favorite memory, one or the other, whatever you think.
I don't know. I suppose one of the great events was that they're asking me to be a name professor. From a personal point of view, but other things that happened. Yeah, I know we entertained Reagan here once, I believe. I remember going to that event. And I think one of the other things that's been outstanding is the, what did they call it, retirees and the council, retirement council, because so many of us are retired, kept in touch that way. And I have a, you know, joint professorship in education and statistics. And we always went to their parties. My wife is able now, we don't go. I mean, went to their every Monday, first Monday of the month, they have a get together. And but I think the President's Council, not just the Retirement Council, that's something anybody can belong to, but the President's Council, you have to put in a hunk of money and all that. But the President's Council was a great idea for bringing lay people and others into the fold, and that's been a big source of help to university, obviously.
That's right.
So I think setting up something like that, and a lot of credit goes to, what's her name? She's in charge of the President's Council, pretty much.
Oh, Carolyn Gary.
Carolyn Gary. She was really the backbone of that thing. She's still working.
Yes, she is. She's gone to half-time, and she'll be retiring in June.
I guess her husband's retired. Yeah. Well, she was terrific. Yeah, is terrific. That's right. Those are a couple of things. I don't remember much, except I thought it was a very good school. In allowing people to do some of the things they want to do, like stop consulting every one day a week and things like that. And you know, you're better off in the classroom than if you've been out there. You know what's going on out there.
You bring enrichment into the classroom,
sure,
to the students.
So that I think that's a very important thing to try to be out now. Of course, there's some areas where you don't have any opportunity to do consulting, I guess. But when there are young students, the young professors should take advantage of that. And they should also take advantage of their sabbaticals. This is a little that concerned me, not serious, but I didn't get a sabbatical until 1970. I'd been here
since 53.
Nearly 25 years. I'm married 20 years. Only because administrators were not given sabbaticals. Now, I guess they are. They ought to be, because you see, you have two vacations. One when you retire, but another one when your boss retires, or when your boss goes on leave, or whatever they do. Yeah, Isaacson was my associate dean, associate president, associate department head, and he was terrific. You have ever interviewed him?
I think I've not interviewed him, but I think I've met him.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'll have to interview
him. Because
he
lives out
in
Colorado now.
Oh, okay.
They've gone to a village like this in Colorado.
Okay.
Just got a card from him for Christmas. But he was great. But he headed up and was responsible for the building of counseling and guidance here. He really was. The other guy, yeah, I was thinking Nelson. You know, Nelson.
Yeah, Dick
Nelson. Of course,
Nelson.
You know Betty.
Sure.
And I hired him from Ohio State, I believe.
Uh-huh.
It was my wife's alma mater.
Oh, okay.
That isn't the reason I hired him. So some of these people I remember that I hired, they're retired or getting ready to. Well, it's hard to believe you've been away from it 23 years.
To keep in touch.
Okay. I try to. And Hyde was wonderful. Getting me involved. came up, of course. And I heard Bob had been dean there, but I didn't know a thing about who they were going to hire as a dean. Well, they hired Hine, and so I got a phone call, and he wanted to have lunch with me. And I thought, well, maybe Professor Herring will be there, you know, she had been dean for a while, and some other people. It was one-on-one, and over in the Sagamore room. And what the first thing he was telling me was that he studied statistics out of my book. And he never let me forget that, even on his Christmas card, even though he's off someplace now in Arizona, that he remembers having my book as a student.
That's very
good.
He was
an awful good man. Sorry to see him leave here. Of course, I guess he got far better set up, I don't know. But I think they took very good care of professors, and as I started to say, I think that young professors should take every opportunity to take that year off. And I got two, one in 70, and one, I guess, in 81. But unfortunately, now, of course, I think administrators don't take them. I remember one of my administrators, be nameless, but he was always saying, well, you had to be there. You can't take a vacation, essentially saying, well, you've got to keep in touch with us while you're away when I was department. And I said, look, if that department can't run well for a month and I'm going to be away or 2 weeks, there's something matter with me as well as the department. But there are people like that. They have to be there. They have to do it. Or he'll, girls, yeah, you know.
Understand.
You know the old thing about the, probably can't even remember. That's one of the problems you run into, by the way.
Okay.
Not being able to remember names.
Yeah. Any closing comment? I think you shared quite a few lines. It's been very nice.
Well, yeah. I've told you more than you wanted to know, probably.
Very good.
But those are the highlights of what we tried to do here. And since that time, yeah, I've enjoyed just being a professor here more than else, and wonderful students to work with always, don't you know?
Right.
Helen and I taught one summer in China, and those are terrific students, by the way. Chinese, I mean, you give them an assignment, they do it, no question about it. So that was a good experience. Now, she was the teacher, I just carried her books, but I tried to teach them a little math.